In this video, I want to talk about the hypothalamic pituitary axis. This system is really important in physiology. It links the brain and the endocrine systems together, and it allows an animal to coordinate an appropriate response to some change in its environment at a body-wide level. The key players in this system are the hypothalamus and the pituitary, and I've outlined the region in the brain where we would find them right here. Well, the hypothalamus is actually part of the brain itself. It's a region of the brain, and it contains many neurons, some of which are arranged in discrete nuclei. So if we look at a blow-up of the hypothalamus, each one of the different colors here is representing a different nucleus or region in the hypothalamus, and there are different types of neurons in these different regions which are going to be carrying out different functions. The other part of the system will be the pituitary gland, and that's what I'm pointing to with the arrow in each of these pictures. In this video, I'm focusing on the human pituitary gland, and in that system, we can divide the pituitary into two parts, the anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary. I should mention that in lower vertebrates, there's also a third part, the intermediate pituitary, but we don't really see much of that in the human. Well, the anterior pituitary is also called the adenohypophysis. It is derived from the roof of the mouth during development, and it's not neural. It contains several types of different endocrine cells. The other part of the pituitary, the posterior pituitary, is nervous tissue. It's called the neurohypophysis. It's also called the pars nervosa. And literally these mean the part of the hypothalamus that's nervous tissue. This part contains the nerve terminals of neurosecretory cells whose cell bodies lie in the hypothalamus. There's a physical stalk that carries the axons connecting the hypothalamus where the cell bodies lie and the site of release in the posterior pituitary. This is called the infundibulum. And although in pictures like this, the pituitary is often just sort of shown hanging down and floating free, I want to remind you that the brain, including the pituitary, is encased by bones. And so there's a sphenoid bone that has a little pocket in it in which the pituitary is going to sit. Here I've drawn a cartoon of the system. Let me begin by orienting you. Up here we have the hypothalamus, and there are a couple landmarks. This is the optic chiasm, and this bump back here corresponds to the mammillary body. The optic chiasm lies at the front edge of the hypothalamus. The mammillary body lies towards the rear, and that allows us to have an anterior-posterior landmark. This would be the anterior pituitary then, and here's the posterior pituitary. Well, remember that I said that the posterior pituitary contains the nerve terminals of neurosecretory cells whose cell bodies lie in the hypothalamus, and we can see that here. The cell bodies of the neurons that terminate in the posterior pituitary lie either in the supraoptic nucleus or in the paraventricular nucleus. These neurosecretory cells have these large cell bodies. We call them magnocellular neurons. And in the supraoptic nucleus, all of the neurons there are magnocellular. In the paraventricular nucleus, there are also some other smaller neurons that are called the parvocellular neurons, and I'll come back to those in a little bit. For now, I want to focus on the ones that are involved in the posterior pituitary. These magnocellular neurons each produce one of two different hormones, either oxytocin or vasopressin. And both the supraoptic nucleus and the paraventricular nucleus contain neurons who release each of these hormones. These peptide hormones are released not onto other nerve cells, but into a capillary system, and from here they can be carried to cells in the rest of the body. What are their functions? Well, oxytocin plays a role in parturition. That's the process of childbirth, so initiating uterine contractions and birthing itself. Also plays a role in lactation and maternal behavior. There's a role in appetite regulation and social recognition, and there's a role in males in sexual behavior. Vasopressin functions in fluid balance and in blood pressure. All right, well, what about the hormones from the anterior pituitary? Well, the anterior pituitary releases six hormones. They are ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, prolactin, GH, growth hormone, and then FSH and LH, follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, and these last two together are called the gonadotropins. Now, although the cells in the anterior pituitary are not neural, they're not nerve cells, they are controlled by the nervous system. And let me walk you through this. So remember how I said in the paraventricular nucleus, there were some of these neurons with smaller cell bodies, the parvocellular neurons? Some of these neurons send their axons down and terminate in the median eminence, that structure at the base of the hypothalamus where there's a capillary system. And they can release then a releasing hormone that can get carried through a portal venule to another capillary system lying over the anterior hypothalamus. And what that means is that something that's released by the cells in the paraventricular nucleus can then influence the anterior hypothalamus. Let me give you some specific examples. There are two sets of parvocellular neurons in the paraventricular nucleus that regulate the release of hormones from the anterior hypothalamus. One set produces a compound called CRH, corticotropin releasing hormone. This compound, if it gets released in the median eminence and then carried to the anterior pituitary, leads to the release of ACTH. There's another set of parvocellular neurons that are releasing something called thyrotropin releasing hormone. And if that compound is carried to the anterior pituitary, there's another set of cells there that will respond to it by releasing thyroid-stimulating hormone. Now, not all of the neurons that influence the anterior pituitary cells lie in the paraventricular nucleus. Another important site is the arcuate nucleus. The arcuate nucleus contains several different types of neurons, but some of them are neurosecretory cells and are going to have projections that terminate in the median eminence. So, for example, there is a set of neurons in the arcuate nucleus that make and release dopamine into the median eminence. We normally think about dopamine as being a neurotransmitter and influence other neurons, but here it's being used as a hormone. The dopamine that's released acts on cells in the anterior pituitary, and it inhibits the release of prolactin. Two other sets of cells in the arcuate nucleus can release either GHRH, growth hormone-releasing hormone, or GnRH, gonadotropin-releasing hormone, and these can then act on the pituitary to lead to the release either of growth hormone or of the gonadotropins, follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. The case of the neurons that are making gonadotropin-releasing hormone is really interesting. These neurons are actually born in the nose in a structure called the olfactory placode, and they have to migrate into the brain. In humans, most of these neurons end up in the arcuate nucleus, but in other organisms, like rodents, many of the cell bodies for these gonadotropin-releasing hormones lie elsewhere in the hypothalamus, in the anterior hypothalamus. But once the hypothalamus stimulates their release or inhibits their release, what do these anterior pituitary hormones do? In a nutshell, I'll say ACTH is involved in the stress response, so a physiological stressful or a psychological stressful set of conditions can lead to the release of ACTH, which will then lead to the release of the glucocorticoids. TSH is thyroid-stimulating hormone. It acts on the thyroid gland to trigger the release of thyroid hormone, which increases metabolic rate. Prolactin will stimulate milk production. Growth hormone is involved in growth and metabolism. And then the gonadotropins, FSH and LH, are involved in sex hormone production in the gonads, the ovaries or the testes. Okay, well, I've shown you several cartoons, but now I wanted to show you some actual histological slides so we could see some structures. So let me orient you. This is the hypothalamus. Up here is the optic chiasm. Down here is the pituitary with the anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary. We can see the infundibulum, that stalk that's connecting the posterior pituitary to the hypothalamus. And also this section shows us the sphenoid bone, so you can see where the hypothalamus is sitting. This particular tissue is stained using a technique called H&E stain, hematoxylin and eosin. And what you should know about this is that hematoxylin is a basic dye and it binds to RNA and DNA. So wherever you see more of the blue color, the hematoxylin, it means that there are more cell bodies. So remember, the posterior pituitary had very few cells. The anterior pituitary was cellular, and we can see this difference. The anterior pituitary is more blue. Eosin stains mainly proteins, and that's why we see pink color in the posterior pituitary, even where there are relatively few cells. This is an even higher magnification image, so again, reinforcing the idea that the anterior pituitary has many cell bodies, whereas the posterior pituitary is mainly these nerve endings. Well, up to this point, I've been talking about the hypothalamic pituitary axis, and I've been stressing how the nervous system and the hypothalamus can influence the endocrine system. But there's also feedback loops that allow the endocrine system and hormones to influence the brain. And I want to give you a couple of examples of this. I'll begin with that stress response. So here will be our hypothalamus, here's the anterior pituitary, and the target then for the hormones I'm going to be talking about will be the adrenal cortex. This hypothalamus anterior pituitary and adrenal gland together are called the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. So this is going to be the system where we're going to have cells in the paraventricular nucleus that will be releasing CRH at the median eminence that gets carried through a local blood supply to the anterior pituitary, where it's going to act on a subset of cells that then in turn release ACTH. The ACTH travels through the general body circulation to its target tissues in the adrenal gland. Now, there are a number of different types of cells in the adrenal gland, but a subset of them, in response to ACTH, will start synthesizing and releasing the steroid hormone cortisol. Cortisol has a number of actions. So if you've had a physiology class, you'll know that it acts on the liver and on fat cells and on muscle cells and on bones, allowing the body to get the energy it needs to respond to a stressful situation. But in addition to these targets, cortisol feeds back to the hypothalamus and to the anterior pituitary, where it can inhibit the release of ACTH and CRH. Let me give you one more example, and this time we're going to look at the hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis. In this system, we're going to be looking at the hypothalamus, the anterior pituitary, but then the target tissue will be the gonads, either ovaries or testes. Well, let's look at this system. Here it's a little bit more complicated because remember that there are neurons in both the arcuate nucleus or in the preoptic area that can produce and then release GnRH, gonadotropin-releasing hormones. Those were the ones that had to migrate from the nose during development. It's also more complicated because these neurons themselves are under control of other neurons in the hypothalamus, so that both the arcuate nucleus and the anterior hypothalamus contain neurons that produce a compound called kisspeptin, and the ones in the arcuate nucleus produce kisspeptin and yet another one called dynorphin, so that there are multiple neurotransmitters being released regulating the activity of the GnRH neurons. Kisspeptin is excitatory, so if those neurons are active, then GnRH will be released. Dynorphin provides feedback. It's a feedback on autoreceptors on the cell itself and shuts off the release of kisspeptin from these neurons. Regardless of where the cell bodies of the GnRH neurons are lying, they're going to release GnRH into the median eminence, and that will get carried to the anterior pituitary. And there are cells there that are producing follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormones, and those will be released then into the general body circulation. They can make their way to target tissues, the ovaries or the testes, and there, those tissues will start producing and releasing sex steroids, like estrogen and testosterone and progesterone. Now, I am greatly oversimplifying things here. If you've had a human physiology course, you'll know that, in particular for females, that the release of estrogen and progesterone are quite complicated. So initially, follicle-stimulating hormones will lead to follicular development and estrogen secretion. But then later, after ovulation, we get the release of progesterone. So I'm simplifying things. But leaving all those details aside, let's look at the feedback loops. So here, the steroid hormones can feed back. Estrogen, when it's released, can feed back onto those kisspeptin neurons in the hypothalamus, and it actually provides a positive feedback loop. So when estrogen is released, it feeds back, activates those neurons so that even more kisspeptin will be released and more GnRH and more FSH and LH. But progesterone, when it feeds back, inhibits this system. So there can be multiple hormones feeding back and sort of battling it out in order to regulate the release of these hormones from the brain. Now, in addition to these hormones that are feeding back directly onto the hypothalamus, you've got to remember that there are many other neurons in different parts of the brain that also have receptors for estrogen or progesterone, for testosterone, and those could also be modulating the activity of these neurons in the hypothalamus. The neuroendocrine system is complicated and fascinating, but I think we'll leave it there.